Welcome to Videville Church. This is our study in the topic of gifts of the Spirit, the love of God, the Word of God, the Bible. You could call it a Bible study per se, but it's also a study about human beings. It's about people. It's about God. It's about you, and it's about me. Now, any study, whenever I do the Corinthian studies or studying of the book of Corinthians, talking about those people that lived at Corinth at the time, which were first called Christian, I'm always reminded to think of the Roman church as being typical of America as a whole. But the Corinthians now, I begin to see that more as like evangelicals. Because you see, I was not ever called an evangelical until 20 years later, after I was out of, or still part of, the Jesus movement, but looking back, they called us evangelical. Now, at the time, that's not what we were called. We were called Jesus freaks. But a lot of times, people mistake what evangelicals are today for what they really are as far as God is concerned. And what God might look at you and me, He might call us Corinthian. He might not call us evangelical. He might not call us any other thing, but He is speaking to each and every one of us because there's a certain amount of Corinthian in every one of us. There's a Corinthian in you and there's a Corinthian in me. And there's something that each one of us could learn from the Corinthians. Because you see, that's kind of how God operates. He doesn't simply say, hey, this is for them then, but it's not for you now, and it'll never be for anyone in the future. That's not how God works. God takes, by His own Spirit, pours it out upon all flesh that they should at least receive a measure of faith. That measure of faith for some person could be a thimbleful. That measure of faith that's poured out upon all flesh could be a glassful. Speaking of glass, it could be a cupful overflowing. But whatever it is, that measure of faith is something that you take unto God, allowing for salvation to come to you, and then you making the choice to follow Jesus or not. Paul, writing to the Corinthians, is speaking to people who have dedicated their lives to following Jesus. These people, specifically, were heading in a direction to learn from Paul and to learn from anyone else who might have the very oracles of God, that might be inspired by God to give them more understanding of what was happening to them. Because just like me, when I got saved, there were things I didn't understand. There were things that were happening that I wound up baptized the Holy Spirit. I wound up speaking in tongues. I wound up doing miracles. I wound up healing people. And I haven't a clue what it was called. I didn't know the right thing to say. I didn't know the right thing to do. I had barely just gotten the Bible, and I barely got saved, and God was doing all kinds of miracles through me. So when I talk about Corinthians, I'm talking about something that's very personal and real to me. Because in a lot of ways, I was like the Corinthians. Although, in other ways, they are far from me as the East is from the West. But regardless of how you are, or how I am, God knows how to make the book and the letter to the Corinthians fit to each and every one of us personally. He knows how to take His own Spirit, speak to us, and cause our spirit to connect with that. Because you see, when you were born again, you were given not only a measure of faith, but you were born again not of the flesh, but of the Spirit. And because you become born again, you now operate in a way that you don't understand yet, a way that you're still growing and learning how to adapt to. That's what we're talking about when Paul writes his letter to the Corinthians. They are still learning. They're not stupid, but they're not mature yet either. So there's a lot of things that we're going through slowly. A lot of things that we're looking at intensely. A lot of things that are specifically designed and written for us to benefit from. And as we have studied before, we have gone through verse 1. Paul, called to be an apostle of Jesus Christ through the will of God, and Sosthenes, our brother. Interestingly enough, we know that Paul now, as being called to be an apostle, through the will of God, that the will of God was for Paul to be an apostle, not because man wanted to, but because God wanted him to. We know that in verse 2, as we read it, unto the church of God, which is at Corinth, and that's why it's called Corinthians. To them that are sanctified to Christ Jesus, called to be saints, with all that in every place call upon the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, both theirs and ours. Now, it's an interesting statement there, because that's what we're going to study tonight. The part that we're studying is there in verse 2, where it says, to them that are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, with all that in every place call upon the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. With all in every place that call upon the name of the Lord. You see, it's interesting because that is an allusion or a connection that Paul is making to a scripture that says, they that call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now we're talking about they that call upon the name of the Lord that are calling him Jesus Christ our Lord. In other words, there's specifically a certain amount of people that this is written to. This is not written to the unbeliever. This is not written to be something taken apart or put up on a nice plaque, because why would you? It's not something that's designed in order for them to be able to ever live it or to do it. Because it is of the Spirit and by the Spirit and in the Spirit that we know we have our life and our being and our acceptance of God because of the atonement that Jesus has done for us, then we likewise must look at this in Corinthians when God is speaking to us about His Spirit and writing to those who have His Spirit. In other words, He's not going to write to some person who doesn't have the gifts of the Spirit. He's not going to write to some person that doesn't have some kind of anointing of God. He isn't going to write to someone that doesn't believe in any of the parts of the Holy Spirit, or any might not even believe in the Holy Spirit. Some people actually don't. But He's going to write this thing unto them that are sanctified in Christ Jesus and called to be saints, with all that are in every place, with all that in every place call upon the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, both theirs and ours. Now, wording that weirdly as it is speaks funny, because that's kind of the way I speak sometimes, in using kind of a reverse inclusiveness that goes outward to go back inward. He's talking not only to the Jews, but he's talking also to the Gentiles. He's saying, look, they over there that call upon the name of the Lord, the Galatians, the Thessalonians, the others that have been there in Jerusalem and have been around for a while, that are following Jesus, that likewise have some of the manifestations of the gifts of the Spirit. But now he's speaking specifically to a large body or a greater body of believers that are using and operating in the gifts of the Spirit without being necessarily Jewish, and not specifically knowing what they're doing. Which I like that, because that kind of puts you and I in a safe place and in a comfortable place. It means that we don't have to have things always known about, practice, exercise, you know, pragmatic, theomatic, you know, get our doctrine and theology down before God automatically uses it for His own benefit. Sometimes things happen that we don't even know what we're doing. And that's okay, and that's what we want to share tonight with you. You don't have to go out there and, you know, slap down, you know, some Pentecostal church because they don't praise the way you do. You may be more in control, they may be more out of control. Vineyard itself, I know that at one time it had gotten so carried away that they had this kind of like outlandish or outrageous experience where they appeared to be dark, barking like dogs or rolling around on the floor, but really it was just overcome with emotion. It was not a gift of gold dust or anything like that. That's a Pentecostal heresy. But rather, it was just like the Corinthians, overwhelmed by the Spirit. When I myself got saved, I had this overwhelmed emotional response that was so magnificent that I just kind of, I stood there and I almost fell down to my knees, but I was able to stand. But 40 days later, and it was weird because I didn't count the days, I didn't know it until I realized afterwards, but 40 days later, when I was in a home Bible study and I was baptized in the Holy Spirit, I no more could have stood than I could understand what I was saying. And then later I understood when I asked God for understanding. He gave me the gift of speaking in tongues, as for those others around me to manifest to them something that was going on at that time, because there were a lot of people around me that had gone there specifically for that, and I had just simply gone to study the Bible. Now, they were jealous, and they made themselves known, but God was using it to teach something, to make me aware of, not by our desire do we get gifts of the Spirit or things happen to us, but by the will of God, by God doing it to us, not because we want it or we know what it is. I never asked to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. I never asked for the gifts of the Spirit. I never asked for words of wisdom, words of knowledge, or any other thing. I didn't ask to be imbued on high with power. I didn't ask for anything. I didn't even ask to be, you know, part of the thing going on. I just simply sat there studying my Bible and praying to Jesus. And boom, poof, and it was like all over with. Pretty crazy about a couple hours later when I was like babbling in the Holy Spirit, and it was just magnificent. I mean, I was so overwhelmed that I would tell people that, hey, you know, if I'd have been stand up, I would have been slain in the Spirit. Although I don't believe in that specifically, because I don't think you go along slapping people in the head and knocking them down. But I can say this, in a genuine experience of overwhelming emotion, yes, I would have fell down, because I was sitting in a chair and I couldn't get out of that chair for a couple hours. It was, and still is, one of the most incredible, miraculous experiences of my life. That is what happened in Corinth. We don't know if it happened to everyone in Corinth. We don't know if it happened to only some in Corinth. But we know that they were all just amazed and excited and overwhelmed like Jesus freaks of what had happened to them when the Spirit of God had visited their church. We look at, in this portion of the scripture, with all that in every place, call upon the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, because it isn't just enough to call yourself a Christian. It isn't just enough to think that you're a peculiar church. It isn't enough to think that you are the only one. You see, the Spirit of God went out into all the world, and He is the one who is restraining evil, and even now, as He is receding, like the tide being pulled back, and preparing to leave this world for the last time, before Jesus comes again, even so as He did with the Shekinah glory that was in the temple that disappeared and never came back until Jesus walked into the temple and prophesied against it, the house of prayer. We know that the Holy Spirit even today is being pulled back, demonstratively so, by seeing what's happening in the church, in Israel, and in the life of the believer, and in the world as evil is manifesting itself and growing. We see that people that should be having discernment or gifts are going off on tangents and following doctrines of demons and lies and things that never would have once been named among them. And yet they're doing it. We see even in the presidency a man who is no longer qualified to be a president, but is a businessman making business deals according to what he thinks he knows. And God knows that if he doesn't get help, may ruin the country or cause the country to stagger in some way. We call it the rise of the anti-president. And that it's the end of the age of grace, or the end of grace to America, or the end of grace for America, or America gets shot, whatever it is. Something like that. But basically the idea is that for over 200 years, God has shed His grace on America, and now we're being held accountable. This man is making some statements that are going to get us damned. And it's not something that we can say that we support, but it's something that we can say we'll pray and stand against in the name of Jesus, because no one man can make a decision for an entire nation, but he can cause an entire nation to fail and to fall. So we pray for him for his salvation, but likewise, like Corinthians, hey, you're going to read about some things that were going on there that were so important, you wonder how could they put up with it. That will be true too, as we watch and see what happens to the man that God has allowed to that God has allowed the people to choose whom they want over them, when in reality God may have chosen someone else or something else. So here we are today. We are operating with those that are also our brothers and sisters that are in America. We are knowledgeable of also those that are called that aren't studying tonight even. There is an entire body of Christ that is out there that is unified with us. Not because they teach the same thing, or that they agree in the same way, or that they pray in the same way, or do anything the same. but they are those that also are calling upon the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. I know for myself, I hear a lot of messianic messed up people that get carried away into their Hebraic study of roots, that they think that they want to change the name of Jesus to Yeshua, and then after that from Yeshua to Yehoshua, which is fine, but then they go to Yehoshua, and then they go to Yahaha, and then they get into Yehoho, and then you get into like, what are you saying? You're sounding like a fool, because they have taken the image of the incorruptible God and made him into the image of corruptible man by changing the Hebrew into something it is not, sadly. And that's what's happened also, as we read later, in the Corinthian church. They have taken something that's holy and unfortunately made it common and almost profane. So, likewise, we should examine ourselves. We should know that we're a part of a greater whole. Never doubt that, even though there may be, you know, like I always say, hey, you know, Paula White's a pastor. God bless her. I mean, if God has called her, then God bless her. If God hasn't called her, then God take care of her, because God knows that he'll call her into question and accountability when she gets to heaven. And I wouldn't want to be there to account for her. I just want to be where I have to accept grace for what I have done. But God knows that when she had chosen to say to the public that Donald Trump is a Christian and that she had done it, I'd have to question what does she think a Christian is? Because in my own personal estimation, I cannot dare to say that I would call any man a Christian that would lie. I wouldn't dare to call any man a Christian that would cheat. I wouldn't dare to call any man a Christian that would be derogatory to others or to have the reputation that the man has. Now, Paul had the same problem. Paul, going against the grain, was crucifying by way of secondary means, because he could not get his hands bloody, but causing Christians to be killed in the name of God, where he was such a thorn in the flesh that God put a thorn in the flesh in him. God spoke to him. God knocked him off his horse. God called him, spoke to him, and turned him around in a different direction. But it was obvious that he was going in a different direction. There is nothing about Donald Trump that has indicated that anyone can say he's going in a different direction. He's turned towards God. Isn't there, isn't fruitful, hasn't happened. So, we don't say this book would be for Donald Trump. We don't say this book would be for your ungodly, unsaved loved ones. And you may love them. This book and these writings are not for anyone else but guess who? You. Why you? Well, because you're here today. You're here tonight. You're looking at it and examining these things, whether they could be a part of you, and they should be a part of you as you are connected to a greater whole called the Bride of Christ. Now, the body of Christ is one thing, but the Bride of Christ is something different. You see, you get to determine whether you're a part of that bride or whether you're just a part of the body. Because, see, the body of Christ has cankers in it, it has sores in it, it has cancers, it has tumors, it has a lot of things wrong in it. You know, parts of the body are warring against itself. Its immune system is technically gone. The Spirit of God is pulling back. It's diseased, it's limping, it's loose, it's gotten a lot of issues. And that is all Christians as a whole collectively looked at in what we call Christendom. But individually, as members of the body of Christ, we have a choice to make. If we're looking for the soon return of Jesus, Jesus is going to pull his bride out of the body of Christ that dies to give birth to a new creation. Old things are passed away, the church, the body of Christ. A new thing has come, the bride, who has made herself ready to ascend to the marriage supper of the Lamb. That is what you could be a part of. Thinking of it that way, then you need to be like the wise virgins and not like the foolish. That's why we study these things, to make ourselves applicable to the opportunity for God to choose us as a chaste and select bride, looking for the Master's return, hoping to be that with which God has called for his Son. We must prepare ourselves to be worthy of that. So, when Paul is writing to the Corinthians, he's writing to people that he has to be careful about saying things and doing things and meaning things so they don't get ahead of themselves because they have an experience of something that they don't have the foundation for, and they are going to possibly be led more by emotion than devotion to the Word of God. In every place that calls upon the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. You know, I keep thinking about that, in every place. Why would Paul say that? Because there was a division happening already in Corinth. You see, the ones in Jerusalem thought they were hotty-totty until Jerusalem was destroyed in 70 AD. Jesus had warned the church, get out of Jerusalem, go out into the uttermost parts of Samaria, Judea, and around the world. This gospel must go forth. Go out and preach and teach, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Make disciples of all nations. They'd heard it. They understood it, but they were busy organizing church in Jerusalem. They were busy getting religion started in Jerusalem. They were busy being in where they were comfortable until God kicked them out of their comfort zone. So they wound up being cast out into the outermost parts of Ursa Major, Ursa Minor, to all these different lands and places and peoples as the Spirit of God led them, but also as they were driven, some of them. Unfortunately, many Jews died when Jerusalem fell. But all is what Paul is trying to say to connect the church in Corinth, which was wealthy and prosperous, to the church in Jerusalem, which would have been two opposites extremes. It's kind of like when people tell me today that the Catholic Church is so far gone that there are no Christians in the Catholic Church, and I tell them they're wrong. That's false. It's not true. In the letters to the seven churches, there are Christians that are dynamic, powerful, and ministering in the Catholic Church. Even a priest I know called Father Bob, that is a charismatic priest that does not push Mary and all the other doctrines, but is someone who believes that he is born again of the Spirit, that is a Jesus freak in Catholic form, that God sent him and called him and chose him to be in the Catholic Church until he dies, teaching people to follow Jesus. I'm not going to quantify him, but I'm going to tell you that he had more knowledge than I did at one time, and his calling and election was sure. So he is one of those that call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and does not have all the other accoutrements that some people do. There are others that you would think less so or more so of being a part of the body of Christ. I know that there are people that call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ like Mormons, but that's not who Paul is talking about. Because unfortunately, the Mormons that call upon Jesus aren't calling upon Jesus, the Son of God, the Son of Man, but a Jesus they created after their own hands or their own meanings, their own purpose, their own design. But we must recognize that when we have much, like the Corinthians do, when you have the gifts of the Spirit, like you should do, you must recognize to whom much is given, much is required. You're not allowed to simply go out and participate in, hey, let me just bless myself and speak in tongues. That's not what you're supposed to do. You're supposed to be interconnected and interlocuted with the rest of the body of believers that are possibly not as blessed or as empowered or knows or experiences the same thing you do. That's why Paul writes it in such a way to say that in every place call upon the name of the Lord. Every place. Now I know you're going to say, well, what about the Mormons? Well, you know, again, you got to start at the top and work your way down to the bottom. You know what I mean? Paul called to be an apostle of Jesus Christ through the will of God, blah, 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 so I'll say, unto the church of God, which is at Corinth. When you assemble yourselves together with a certain amount of people, you get to know their strengths, but you also see their weaknesses. You understand that they're flesh, so if they fall, you pick them back up, hopefully, and restore them. If they get carried away, then you get carry them out, you know, so eventually they get carried back in, you know, but one way or another, you understand the people that you are assembled with. Paul is simply saying in general terms, remember that not only are you assembled in the local body, but you are also connected with the external believers that are all throughout the world. Now, the reason why I mention that specifically, and the reason why I have to say that to some people, is to remind them that you're not it. you're not the prime example, either you Calvary Chapel, or you Vineyard, or you Pentecostal, or you Church of God, or Assembly of God, or Lutheran, or Methodist, or Roman Catholic, or Armenian. But God is all. Because it's in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's not you, it is Him. It is He who is our Lord, He who is our Master. We are interlocuted, because I know that you, if you decided to go to worship service, wouldn't think twice about going to see a concert of your favorite Christian artist. And I can tell you this, that there's probably members from all kinds of churches there that are enjoying it likewise. And that's the unity of the body of believers that we're called to be. No, you can't become a unity based upon your own differentiations between separations, that the designations are obvious in the letters to the seven churches, that each and every one of them were different than the other. No, you can't say that to, you know, someone to say, hey, we got to be all together and let's go unify ourselves. That's not what Jesus is talking about. It's a unity in the knowledge of Jesus Christ our Lord. Jesus is the unifying factor. The Father is what unifies us all by His gathering us together as one. He will one day bring us, in the name of His Son, to Himself, that we should see Him. And when we do, we'll all fall down. Believe me, there's no way that we'll stand in the presence of God. You will fall on your face, and it won't be on your knee. But that's why, consistently, you're going to see, even in gifts of the Spirit, when people are jealous, or people are different, or people have this, and people have that, you can't separate yourself unto yourself. You have to remember that there are others that are a part of who you are that have contributed to becoming what you are, and that will in the future probably influence you to become the way you are. Because that's how we are the body of Christ. We're meant to be believers unto the Lord Jesus Christ. And if we aren't, then we have no business calling ourselves Christian, and we have no business thinking that because we're here at Corinth, where they first called themselves Christians, that we are a part of that. If you hate your brother, then you are not a Christian. We are known by the fact of our name, but really, to our shame, that name has been defamed in ways that was never Christian. What we must become and recognize is that in our spirit, we still are a part of the body of Christ. Of all those that in every place call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ.